Friends, welcome to Granite Springs Church. We are so delighted that you're joining us for this, the third week of the church season we call Advent. Advent is a season where we long and we hope, and we do that together. We long for a better world. We long for a better country. We long for a better neighborhood. We long for a better self, and we hope. We put our hope in the one who is worthy of our hope. Friends, welcome. We are delighted that you are joining us, and we hope this service will be a gift to you.
Hear these words from Isaiah chapter 61, verses 10 through 11. I delight greatly in the Lord, for my soul rejoices in my God, for he has clothed me with garments of salvation and arrayed me in a robe of his righteousness. As a bridegroom adorns his head like a priest, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels, for as the soil makes the sprout come up and a garden causes seeds to grow, so the sovereign Lord will make righteousness and praise spring up before all nations. Today we light the shepherd's candle, reminding us of the joy proclaimed by the angels to the shepherds and the joy we anticipate with Christ's coming, the joy of healing, the joy of redemption.
Our call to worship comes from Psalms 126. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dreamed. Our mouths were filled with laughter, our tongues with songs of joy. Then it was said among the nations that the Lord has done great things for them.
In our waiting, in our Advent waiting, we are sustained by knowing that God is faithful to his promises, and particularly the promises found in baptism. Let's have this conversation remembering those promises together.
As we wait, we hold on to the promise of baptism. God calls us his beloved children. As we wait, we extend love and peace to one another. God unites us as his people. As we wait, we experience and long for God's joy. God welcomes us in his grace. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen.
True joy, we are called to be a people who both acknowledge the darkness and point beyond it. As we pray together this morning, when I pray, those who sow with tears, would you respond, will reap with songs of joy. Friends, let's pray together. Redeeming God, in our Advent waiting, help us hold on to your words. Those who sow with tears will reap with songs of joy. In our waiting, it is easy for our eyes to grow dim. Our gaze drops from those around us and is filled with our own challenges and anxieties. Thank you that you see us in our struggle and you have compassion on us.
You see our every tear and our deepest aches. In our Advent waiting, hear our longing. Those who sow with tears will reap with songs of joy. As you meet us where we are, fill us with the hope of your good news, that you are not far off, but are working to redeem the world, to fill it with joy and light, goodness and grace. Help us to be like John the Baptist, humbly pointing beyond ourselves to you. In our Advent waiting, help us point to your hope. Those who sow with tears will reap with songs of joy. As we bear witness to your compassion, help us work with your Spirit among our families and friends, our neighborhoods and our worlds. Help us be known for sowing seeds of righteousness and praise, peace and joy. And we pray that you would cause those seeds to grow, that we might see our world flourish. In our Advent waiting, help us share your redeeming news. Those who sow with tears will reap with songs of joy. Amen.
In this season of Advent, we are waiting for the coming of Jesus. And in our waiting, we are invited to offer our gifts to the coming King. Not because we're in debt to the King or our King, not because our King requires us to give, but instead we are invited to give out of joy and gratitude, knowing and trusting that our God, our King, is coming for us to make all things new. So whether you give online or mail in your offering to the church, friends, we invite you to experience joy in the midst of your waiting. Let's pray for our offering. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, in our acts of generosity, as we hear your word and as we worship together with your church around the world, you point us to yourself. You draw our eyes toward your grace, your truth, and your generous welcome to all peoples. Help us to point to these things as well by your Spirit. And in the name of Jesus, Amen. And friends, God extends his peace to us, and he calls us to pass the peace. Think about that. We are called to bring peace, God's peace, to wherever we go. Not anxiety, not resentment, not complaints. You know, we can pass all those things to wherever we go, but instead, God calls us to receive his peace and pass the peace to those around us, wherever we go, wherever we are. So let me do that first and invite you to do the same, whether you text somebody or call somebody or turn to those around you. Friends, may the peace of Christ be with you.
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 There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. Now this was John's testimony when the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him who he was. He did not fail to confess, but confessed freely, "I am not the Messiah." They asked him, "Then who are you? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Finally they said, "Who are you? Give us an answer to take back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John replied in the words of Isaiah the prophet, "I am the voice of one calling in the wilderness. Make straight the way for the Lord." Now the Pharisees who had been sent questioned him, "Why then do you baptize if you are not the Messiah, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" "I baptize with water," John replied, "but among you stands the one you do not know. He is the one who comes after me, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie." This all happened at Bethany on the other side of the Jordan where John was baptizing.
12 years ago, our president-elect called a United States congresswoman from Florida, and she promptly hung up on him. She hung up on him. She gave him no time to explain who he was or why he was calling. She just simply ended the call. She assumed he was a radio host in that area who was known for his ability to mimic voices in such an amazingly accurate way. This radio host apparently could do famous people and could do many presidents. He could do President Bush and President Clinton and President-elect Obama. So she just assumed it was a radio host playing a prank on her. It was only after several friends called and said, "This was President Obama that you hung up on," that she realized what she had done. She assumed the real thing was a prank. This story that we're talking about today has that same kind of feel. The Gospel of John the Evangelist, John the disciple of Jesus, begins with such soaring poetry. We didn't read that part, but it begins, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. All things were made through him, and without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all people." And then in a couple verses later, it's almost as if John, the gospel writer, remembers, oh yes, there's this person out there named John the Baptist, and people may get them confused. So let me tell you, John is not the light. John is only a witness to the light. John is not the one who made the world. John is only a witness to the one who made the world. It's sort of astonishing that people would get those two confused, but apparently they did. Many historians of that era call John perhaps the most noted and famous and most powerful preacher that generation had ever seen. It was John who was famous, not Jesus. A little bit later, after this story that we're reading today, the apostles go to Ephesus to start a new church there, and they run into a group that seems to be a kind of church of John the Baptist. And they say, "Have you heard of Jesus?" And they say, "No, we were baptized in the name of John the Baptist." Jesus, who is that? Even Herod, who was king at the time, thought he had killed, he did in fact kill John the Baptist. But when Jesus was doing miracles afterwards, he assumed John the Baptist had come back to life. There was confusion about who was who. And so John, in this soaring poetry, kind of interrupts himself to clarify, to say, this is no prank call. This is Jesus himself, who is different than John the Baptist. John the Baptist was not the Messiah. John came as the witness to the Messiah. We see this in verse 6 and 7 and 8, and then we see this again in verse 20 and 21. Clarification, it's almost as if John has a reverse resume. You know what resumes are. They promote ourselves. They're a description of things we've done and accomplished, and sometimes they make us look extra rosy. But John has kind of a reverse resume. A resume might say, "I'm the Messiah." John says, "I'm not the Messiah." A resume may say, "I'm a follower of the prophet Elijah." John says, "I'm not the prophet Elijah." A resume may say, "I'm the prophet. The Old Testament has waited for it." But John says, "I'm not that prophet." And his answers get shorter. He begins with a 5-word answer, "I am not the Christ," in verse 20. Then in verse 21, it gets shorter yet, "I am not Elijah the prophet." And then verse 21 at the end says just simply, "No, I'm not that person you think I might be." But he does say something that's very memorable. Among you, he says to those who are being baptized, among you stands one you do not know. That was literally true. There in the crowds by the Jordan River that day stood the Messiah, stood the creator of the cosmos, and nobody recognized him. There he stood with his sandals and his robe and his plain clothes, in line like everybody else, jostling maybe, waiting to be baptized by John, his cousin. And John simply says, among you stands one whom you do not know. You do not know. This was true. This is a kind of Advent mystery already that John was unpacking for us. Common sense, our intuition says we would know who Jesus was. If he showed up in our backyard, we would understand immediately who he was. But he went to dinner with people who were confused about who he was. He went to dinner with people who had casual conversation with the Lord and giver of all life. It's amazing. He was unknown to Herod, the great king. He was unknown to Caesar. He was unknown in all the political courts of the world at the time. He was only known, it seemed, to people who saw him but were blind. He was only known, it seemed, to people who could kind of hear him, even though they were deaf. He was known to people who he healed because they were desperate for his Messiah healing. Among you stands, says John the Baptist, among you stands one you do not know. That's still true today, isn't it? We expect Jesus to come with lights and a production. We expect Jesus to come with crowds that are irresistible. We expect Jesus to come and say something or do something that is amazing to us, that astonishes us. But John simply says, among you comes one you do not know, stands one you do not know. I was reminded of this again this month as I was thinking about one of my favorite Christmas and Advent stories. It comes from Tom Long, who is a professor of preaching at Princeton University and then some other places. Tom tells a story of visiting an old friend of his. This friend was at the last stages of cancer, and he was being cared for by some of their mutual friends. And when Tom came to the door that day, the lawn was covered with Santas and with reindeer, and the neighborhood had a whole assortment of Christmas items. But none of them seemed especially appropriate when he walked in the door, because he knew instantly he would never see his friend again. His friend had that gray, kind of pale look of someone about to die. And in the room, it seemed already death was a kind of unwelcome visitor. And so they talked for a while, and then their conversation, like the conversation of many old friends who are familiar with each other, grew silent. But neither wanted to leave. Well, the friend couldn't leave as he lay on his deathbed, and Tom didn't want to leave. They both knew it was his last Christmas. They both knew it was the last time they would see each other on this earth. And then after a while of silence, there was a sound of shuffling feet at the door. The door had opened, and it became apparent that the church choir had arrived at the building, at the home. And you could hear their muffled voices. You could make out a few things of what they were saying. The muffled choir was saying, should we sing We Wish You a Merry Christmas? No, said one. That doesn't seem appropriate for a dying person. And finally came someone who said, how about, lo, how a rose e'er blooming? Let's sing that. And so up the stairs they came, into the bedroom they came, respectfully they came, singing an Advent hymn that seems to fit Jesus, the one who stands among us, even though we are unaware. They sang like this, lo, how a rose e'er blooming from tender stem hath sprung, of Jesse's lineage coming, as men of old have sung. It came a floweret bright amid the cold of winter, when half spent was the night. And then this beautiful verse at the end, O Savior, child of Mary, who felt our human woe, O Savior, King of glory, who dost our weakness know, bring us at length, we pray, to the bright courts of heaven and to the endless day. A hymn that reflects the spirit and the grace and the love of one who stands among us that we do not know. Friends, this Advent, as we continue to wait, as we continue to long for the one who comes, for Jesus to come to make all our worlds and our personal ills right. Be on the lookout. Be on the lookout for the Savior who comes in unexpected disguises, the Savior who stands among us as one we do not know. friends, we invite you to receive God's blessing. May God go before you to lead you. May God go behind you to protect you. May God go beneath you to sustain you. May God go beside you to befriend you. Friends, in a weary world, do not be afraid, but let the blessing of God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit fall down upon you. Friends, do not be afraid, but go to love and to serve the Lord.